Yeah, I'm down here in the godforsaken land of Phoenix, Gerald. So normally Russ and I are in the same room.
Are you in Phoenix, Arizona right now?
That's the one.
Is that where you live?
Indeed not. They've tried. They've tried.
Oh, you're in a hotel. Okay, I see. Right, okay.
He flies out for the QAnon rallies.
Yeah, I mean, they're still waiting on the drops down here, man.
Stay strong, man. Stay strong.
I'll tell you, though, it's been a good weather, I think it's going to pick up.
Why are you in Phoenix? What are you doing there?
Later today. We're going to get in the mid-90s.
Wow.
Which, again, I'm bad with the Celsius translation there, but...
90s is really hot.
Yeah, there we go.
So you're like, it would be like... 30s, it would be like over 30 degrees for sure.
Now see, sometimes I do have to look up the translation, and I'm out of practice right now, but I was pretty good because I'm a big watcher of the Great British Bake Off. And you know, when they're talking about, oh, it's 30 degrees in the tent today, I'm like, how hot is it in the tent? Is it gonna melt that frosting? conversion charts, man. You know, right. I got to be fully invested in the show.
You should be.
You know, there's no need to give them a buttercream frosting challenge when it's 100 degrees in that tent. That's fair, not fair.
Man, all right. What's Phoenix like? Actually, I heard it's good. Is it all right, Phoenix, Arizona?
Who told you it's good, Gerald? Because they're lying to you.
They're lying? Okay. I just thought it might be all right because, I don't know, Arizona seems like a nice place. Nice and warm. At least it's warm.
Here's the thing. I think this may be the most, the hottest real estate market in the country. Like, so many people are moving here. And I think it's, you know, we got a mass exodus out of California and the pricing and everything. And yeah, naturally, the pricing has gone up here a bit. But, you know, people like the dry air. And I just don't, it's just weird down here for me because there is no, like, there's no identity with Phoenix. It's just a collection of suburbs.
Oh shit. Yeah, I
would with like that. No central culture.
Yeah. I got it. No art. Yeah. Not like San Francisco, which is just like
right. Yeah. Right. This is just a village of nomads.
Which is kind of cool. I don't know. You know, we went out there for work and Randy, I think you know what I'm gonna talk about, but there was like the Gnome bookstore and there was like a there was a weird little street that was, it looked like a suburb had been completely abandoned and they were running illegal businesses out of them, but they also were like storefronts. So like they're making ice cream out of like a family home. There were two bookstores. I remember we went into one and they were doing a poetry related to Pokemon and sexual encounters in the back.
I forgot about that till right now. Yeah.
Yeah. And it was like, what the fuck? There is cool shit out here. And then I, checked up on it like a year later and all those places were gone. So I don't know what happened, but weird. Yeah, I don't know, it looked like a bombed out city.
Well, I'm in the
you guys are like Portland.
I've never made it up there.
It's good.
You guys, Russ, have you been to Portland?
No, and I've had a bunch of people reach out and be like, dude, there's a coffee shop out there that has tabletop games and it's a mixture, and you go, and I'm like, it's almost like two on the nose for me. And I'm like, well, fuck Portland. Like, I'd rather be kind of unhappy down here in a lesser version. Because, I mean, they stole all of our culture. All the people went up there.
That's a bad business move to have tabletop games at a business where you're trying to turn tables over.
Well, next week we'll have John Taffer on and we can ask him.
Well, I'm saying, from a business perspective, this is not a good business move.
I think he wants people to hang out longer. And if you have a drink industry, I think it would be beneficial to have people hanging out for 8 hours a day, just constantly drinking your cold brew.
But see, that's the thing. You got to check up on that. Nah, man, you got to turn those tables, baby.
Turn those tabletops. That's a good name of that restaurant. Anyway, Gerald, we didn't just trick you out here so we could hang out with you. Okay. We actually brought you on because there's been a new Texas Chainsaw Massacre out, and we needed your opinion on it.
Oh, absolutely. Oh,
did you watch it?
I'd love to talk about it. love to talk about the movie. I've been trolling the Texas Chainsaw Massacre Facebook accounts.
Oh, shit.
Writing stupid shit on there like all the time about how it's a masterpiece. Like, I can't remember. Oh, I wish I could find that. I wish I could find the comments. I wrote some real doozies on there. I wrote some really stupid, like, stupid comments on there. I was like, I never had a father growing up, but if I did, I wish he was that Leatherface. Really stupid stuff. But, okay, let's talk about that. Okay, the movie obviously is pretty stupid. But, okay, let's look at the whole series. Let's look at this entire series. You got the first one, which is a masterpiece, I think. I think the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre is one of the greatest Texas, like one of the greatest horror films of all time. I honestly think that.
Hard to dispute that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's not a fun movie. It's not the kind of movie that you watch. It doesn't have like a lot of rewatch value for me because it's kind of a downer, mm-hmm. but it's a great film and it's incredibly realistic, well acted. Not
makes
great
me think of Home.
There you go. It does make me think of it a little bit. I mean, I grew up on a farm, but I thought it was a great movie. The second movie, again, by Tobe Hooper, awesome. I love that film. Super funny, kind of like tonally messy, but just a great movie. So much fun, right? You got Chop Top. Leatherface is more comical.
Dennis Hopper's going crazy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's chopping like a tree with a chainsaw. I love that movie. I have one of the special editions, the Blu-ray here from like Scream Factory. I love that movie. I have the Steelbook of Texas Chainsaw. Leatherface, the third one, didn't really like it. A very forgettable movie. Then you had the fourth one, which is just bizarre, right?
Yeah.
Again, pretty like.
Now, Russ, that's your favorite one, right?
It's one of my favorite. The Matthew McConaughey. You know, it's kind of the first time I remember like the Illuminati appearing in the zeitgeist in like horror films. Yeah. And Matthew McConaughey just going nuts. I don't know that, you know, that was in the era where I had a legal black box where I could watch like, you know, pay-per-view channels and that would play all day. So I just have memories of watching that over and over and over.
It's hilarious, right? Like
yeah.
Matthew McConaughey makes that, right? So after that, what was there? What was the next one that came out after the fourth one? They did this other one, this terrible Texas Chainsaw 3D. That was awful.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty much unwatchable.
That was after the Jessica Biel one, right?
Yeah.
3D?
That was a great movie, though. The Jessica Biel one, like yeah. those two movies, the 2002 or 2003 one with Jessica Biel, and then you had the beginning, the prequel. Those were great movies, like with Arlie Ermey. Like those were awesome films, right? But then you come along with this terrible Texas Chainsaw 3D. Then you had this Leatherface ridiculous prequel where you had this like skinny dude at the end who becomes Leatherface. It was so stupid. It was so stupid.
Yeah.
Those were horrible movies. This was at least entertaining. This latest movie was actually entertaining. The gore was off the charts. It was really dumb, but like Leatherface was pretty scary. At least they made Leatherface pretty scary. The Sally Hardesty character, that was basically just like a ripoff of what they did with Halloween with Jamie Lee Curtis. It basically just stole that and they did it again. And her character was just forgettable. Sally Hardesty was never a really great character.
No.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's funny. I'm reading the Final Girl support group right now. And that book kind of takes like the idea behind that story is that in that reality, all of the franchise films that are slasher movies, they're all based on real murders. So all of the Final Girls are real people who kind of deal with our popular culture, like idolizing the villain. Right. So they live in a world where people cheer on Leatherface. But like, you know, that was a real girl he was trying to kill and all her friends really died. And the Texas Chainsaw Girl, like they change all their names, which makes it pretty confusing. Uh-huh. But I believe she marries a rich Republican and is in a mansion and becomes like an eco-conservative who's like trying to raise money for it. And she's interesting in that book. But the whole time I was reading it, I'm like, wow, you really had like nothing in the movie. Like
right?
The best thing she did was become broken by the end. And, you know, I think that's what you were talking about earlier, where it's like, man, it's kind of a bummer movie because she gets away, but you're not cheering for her. Her life's
but cool. In this one, she looks really cool.
No, she looks badass.
She does. She looks cool.
She does a good job. The actress is good.
And, you know, we've gotten shit before because one episode we recorded, Gerald, me and Clark were talking about a Texas Chainsaw film, but we were talking past each other. Like, we completely mixed a movie. Like, I think Clark knew I was off because I was naming a scene that wasn't in the film he just watched.
I just powered through.
Okay, now just for clarity, I have all the titles in front of me. Look at how similar this shit is. It's Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, Leatherface, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, Texas Chainsaw Massacre Next Generation. Then when we get into 2003, it's Texas Chainsaw Massacre again. Uh-huh. Then it's Texas Chainsaw Massacre The Beginning, then, which is a movie we skipped. Then it's Texas Chainsaw 3D.
Right, terrible.
Then it's Leatherface, which was the movie was that the one you were talking about?
That's the one I saw.
And I thought you were talking about 3D.
I have not seen 3D.
3D, yeah. 3D, I think, was the last one to have Gunnar Hansen in it. If I remember correctly, he had like a cameo in the beginning.
Yeah, a cameo, yeah.
Yeah. So I confabulated that movie with the one you watched. Then there was, then it's back to Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The only thing they dropped was the, but now we're in requel territory, which, Gerald, you're totally right. Like, there are a whole new set of tropes. Which, thankfully, Scream 5 made fun of. They really tackled the requel. Have you seen it?
Not yet. No, I want to.
Oh, dude, watch it. Because they totally come after, like, Blumhouse, pretty much, with the whole Halloween requel shit, which has kind of, you know, become the lay of the land now.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I don't... Dude, me and Clark had a blast watching this new Texas Chainsaw. Totally.
That was so much fun.
It's totally fun. I mean... It's got problems. Like the lead actress, the one that, you know, well, can I say a spoiler? Is that cool?
Yeah, I mean, clearly you don't listen to this show.
Everyone's seen it. They've seen the movie, though. But she gets her head cut off at the end. I called that,
by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, gets pulled out of the car and saws her head off. I don't know. She wasn't... What'd you think of her acting? It seemed a little weak.
Let me put it this way, Gerald. I think I stood up and clapped when her head was cut off.
Right.
Because I had waited 80 minutes for that to happen.
Yeah.
No, so she would stop talking.
Dude, has anyone made a meme about like Elon trying to buy Twitter and like used that? Where it's like some performative like girl getting her head cut off as a Tesla like keeps her prisoner? Dude, Randy, get on that. We're going viral.
But dude, like you could not have a better ending than that.
That was a great ending.
I mean, just 5 stars. That was so good.
It was just like a highly entertaining movie. That's the thing. Like the whole movie was just super entertaining. It was really gory. It didn't take itself very seriously.
No.
The cancel culture thing wasn't too heavy. Like there's a little bit of that, I think, going on there.
But the kills
were super brutal, man. Yeah. That's what you want. Well, it was also well shot.
Dude, very much.
They were kind of scratching that itch with the, you know, Jason Takes Manhattan, where you just want to watch, like, if we're fully aware now that we're cheering for the slasher, let's watch him just murder a bunch of people.
On a bus.
Dude, that party bus, they already kind of, like, if you want to really jam pack
that, but yeah.
Dude, if you just want to jam pack that, all the tropes of like what a shitty teenager does in the slasher and, you know, weekly becomes justification to have them murdered, that, hey, they were all in there on that party bus. I loved it. I kind of want to rewatch it now.
You should. The only thing about the party bus, it was kind of stupid. Was that, did you notice when he was killing her? I've seen the movie twice. When he's killing everybody, he's just, no one fights back.
No one attempts
to tackle him. Like no one does anything.
Which, you know, they're pacifists from Austin.
Oh, sorry, you're right. I'm wrong. I stand corrected. That's probably what the screenwriter said.
100%
director. They're like, they're pacifists.
Well, okay. we're very privileged in this moment to have a test subject. Randy, if Leatherface jumped on your party bus and was murdering your friends, what would you do?
Try to run, but if I can't run, I would just give up.
Just use your nonviolent crisis intervention skills.
I mean, I know that I have like no fight in this, you know?
He's going to take me,
so it's like, what am I going to do?
Randy, you got some rage in there, brother.
What? He's got.
And I like grab Leatherface's nuts and like try to like get him that way, you know, take him down or like poke the eyeballs.
Dude.
No, he's a eunuch, dude.
Did you see the way? Okay. That would not work because did you see the way he grabbed that one guy's arm that first kill and just bent it?
Oh,
it
yeah.
And snapped it. It just was like completely impossible. It just like went against everything about physics. That made no sense.
But it was a perfect way to set the tone for the film.
He broke the guy's arm off like an icicle.
Yeah.
It was hilarious. But it's, and then he stabbed him to death with his own arm bone. That was a great kill. That was a badass kill, man. That was like a Jason kill.
Well, that was truly, that was our real introduction into the movie. Because as you said, like, you know, this thing is paper thin in terms of plot line and the characters. You hate all of them. And, you know, when that happens, the most impressive thing about the movie is that they cut no corners here, man. They cut no corners. Everything looks really good. And it was just fun.
And it was produced by Fede Alvarez, the same guy that, directed one of my favorite movies, the Evil Dead remake, which is one of my favorite remakes and one of my favorite movies. Like, I am a huge Evil Dead fan, and I love that remake. So, and he directed it. At least he produced this. I don't know. I'm not sure who directed it.
But. Yeah, we had one of Fede's homies on the show, Maximiliano. And when the movie came out, I was hitting him up. And I'm like, dude, I have to know. How is Fede taking all of this fucking coverage? Because everybody online was ripping it.
Yeah.
And he was like, dude, he just turned off his notifications. He just doesn't read it. And I was like, well, please let him know that everybody on this show, we had a fucking blast with the movie. We're just, and, you know, I think we represent a group of people that don't jump on Twitter and, like, say it. But I'm like, dude, just let him know. Like, we were cheering. We jumped up and cheered. So, yeah, I don't know. I thought that movie was a win. I've definitely been arguing with other podcasts about it, though.
Well, and the thing is with movies now, it just seems like, you know, no one's happy. Like, if you go on Rotten Tomatoes and you look at reviews for films, you know, so many movies, like, take, for example, House of Gucci. I thought it was great.
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was great. And you know what? You go on there and it gets 60% on Rotten Tomatoes or 59 or whatever. What do you need to do to entertain people these days? Seriously, wow. Like, that was an entertaining movie. It was well done. It was Ridley Scott. And just movies in general, just people just shit all over them. It just takes to please people.
I had a ball watching that, but I was on 10 milligrams of edible marijuana. Of edible marijuana. That may have affected.
Well, Gerald, you've also veered into a lane that we discovered, and we've shown a lot of movies and we've introed stuff that, you know, audiences maybe didn't quite enjoy the way that they were expecting. And there's been times where me and Clark, we would exit a theater after people were clapping and cheering through a movie, but it's at a film fest. So we get the honor of looking at what they actually rated. And they'll walk out, one star. And we're like, what are you doing? And they're like, oh, it was terrible. And I'm like, are you lying? You were crying in the theater because you were laughing so hard. And I'm like, what is this weird? I mean, we know horror movies, people can punch down on them and there's no threat there.
Yeah.
But it's also like, at the end of the day, I think it's just like the way social media fucks with us, because you watch a movie at home alone and you have an opportunity for like a hot take. Like, if you go out there and you're just like, hey, I enjoyed this film, nobody's going to give a fuck. Yeah. So I think people polarize like right away. Yeah, I don't know. I think that's why we need to watch movies together.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, like, honestly, giving a movie 10 out of 10, you really need to think about that. Like, 10 out of 10, like, that's like saying, really? So there was nothing wrong with the movie? So, like, it was just a perfect movie? There's got to be something that you could deduct points from, right? Sure, some movies are 10 out of 10, maybe The Shining. There are some movies like that, or Texas Chainsaw Massacre. But giving a movie 1 star, 1 out of 10, let's really think about that, right? 1 star? There's got to be something there that you liked, right? There's got to be something. There was some effort in there. You're not going to just give it 1 star. I don't know. It's just,
So former third chair on this show, Justin Coote, who, Gerald, I think you may have met at the festival.
Yeah, absolutely.
I believe I bought
a Howling poster from Justin.
That's the one.
Justin was psyched about that. He was like, dude, Gerald's the coolest. Yeah.
And guess what? I got it. I got the frame, and I'm going to pick up the frame for it right after this podcast, and I'm getting it framed.
Holy shit.
Beautiful.
All right. Can I ask a very personal question?
Yes.
Now, as a fan of paper art, mm-hmm. and as a dude who used to spend my tax return framing paper art.
Wow.
How much did it cost?
Wait,
hold on. No, there's a better way to set it up. So it was a full size poster, right? So we're talking 27 by 40 inch. We're this big. Did you go glass? Did you go glass or do you have like the plastic?
I went glass.
Okay.
So I went heavy. Glass and it's going to be heavy. And it was, we went to Opus, got it done at Opus here, and it was actually reasonable. It was $140 for the frame and everything. 140, and I bought it from Justin for 40 American, which was amazing.
Holy shit. Now
$100.
That is incredible. I used to work at Aaron Brothers, which has now become defunct. They're kind of like a high-end framing store. And easily, after a 70% discount, uh-huh. you would still run into over $700 to frame
a
27 by 40.
Huh? What are you talking about?
Dude, easily $1,500 to frame a poster.
What kind of Ponzi scheme is going on here?
Well, here's the thing. So one, they're always going to try and move you into a custom frame. And if you buy a poster from like the 70s, they weren't exactly cut 2740. They actually had a little bit of information on the bottom. So if you don't want to damage it, you got to go custom and you're already through the roof there. Then if you go glass, it's not just glass. You're doing UV.
It's protectant. Mr. Glass.
Yeah, it's Mr. Glass. No, I mean, you do UV protectant, museum glass, which is non-glare. And if you're a social media guy, you want to take pictures.
That was an option.
Yep, and then you got to mat it, because if your art is up against the glass, it's almost, it like becomes like concrete, not concrete. It's like plaster. Like if you remove it 10 years later, it might be stuck to the glass and you'll destroy the art. So
shit.
Easy, minimum, multiple hundreds of dollars. Like 400, I would have been like, wow, great deal. The fact that he did all that under two, it almost makes me want to make an argument for framing everything in Canada.
Well.
I'm not joking.
It's basic, like it's a basic frame, but I mean, it looks like it'll be pretty good.
No, and here, like, no shame, Gerald. For movie art,
yeah,
you kind of want a basic frame. You don't want the frame stealing the vibe from the poster. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Just a thin, like a pretty thin frame, and it's like thin bevel or whatever edge.
Dude,
really nice.
That's incredible, and I'm so sorry for that tangent. But I have
I can't believe it's that expensive. Holy shit.
Yeah, but to just close the book on what Justin was saying, why I brought him up, because he had a rule where if he and it was a 1 to 5 rating, and he said, if you made a movie, I give you a star. I give you 1 star because you made, he said, so I can't rate anything below a 1 because you made a movie. And if that's the only thing that I liked about it, is that you did something I can't do, you get 1 star.
You get 1 star.
Yeah.
Now, Gerald, I have a very simple yet complicated to the plebs I do the show with rating system. I go completely emotional. So a 5 star for me, a lot of the time, is an imperfect film.
Buckle up for this bullshit, Gerald.
No sense. So it's all emotional. I honestly think the worst rating, now this is where I lose everybody, is a 3 star. And the problem with the 3 star is it's completely forgettable. And I think the worst thing you can do is like be boring and make no impact. When I'm looking at art, I would kind of like to feel something. And if it's World War Z, that's a 1 star. And I will never forget that movie. And if you bring it up in conversation, I get angry. And that's, you know, I'm like, oh man, fuck that film. But I also realized that, you know, the opposite of love is not hate. It's apathy. So my thing's all weird. But like Videodrome is my favorite example. I feel like that's a technically great film with an interesting plot and everything's just working for it. And if you're really paying attention, at the end of the movie, you're like, wait, this doesn't work. Like the theory in the film, just it doesn't pan out. And I'm like, you could ding it for that, or you could watch it three or four times trying to figure it out. And I'm like, I think that's like a 5-star for me. Wow. Because I keep coming back to it, or I think about it all the time.
Like a Lynch movie or something.
Yeah. Well, so, yeah. You
know, at least 20 times to understand it.
Dude, beauty's in the imperfection.
Mm-hmm. And your rating system is done.
As long as it's consistent, I think I can get away with it.
5 stars. Very flawed. Hey, out of five.
Dude, make sense. I love shot on video and like regional film. So like Boardinghouse, like that's a movie that would make Clark hurt. Do you remember it, Clark?
I saw it.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't know if you blocked it out, like it was like PTSD or something. But like that film to me is like 4. I love that movie. I remember having a great time, especially because we saw it in theater and like, you know, we're dying every time that text came up and was audibly painful.
Well, they shot it on video and then they transferred it to 35.
Yeah.
Really?
It looked like dog shit.
I believe during the intro, they said it's the only film in history that was like a no budget horror movie that got like an upgrade like that.
Wow.
Yeah. It's probably the reason why it hasn't happened since, too.
What's the name of it?
Boardinghouse. I believe Vinegar Syndrome just put out a beautiful release of it, too.
Was it Vinegar Syndrome?
I'm pretty sure.
I thought it was Cauldron.
No, it's not Cauldron.
Okay.
Yeah, and I only remember because the slipcover is that thick cardboard, that beautiful stuff that only like Vinegar Syndrome and now kind of Severn is doing.
Yeah. 28 Days Later, that was shot on video. That was actually one of those old Canon. Do you remember those big camcorders Canon had? The Canon XL1. Remember those big ass video cameras that were out and big pro?
Oh, hell yeah.
It was like a 480p camera, and that's what they actually shot that on. That was shot in 480p, and then it was like transferred to 35, and on the big screen that looked shitty too. It kind of worked for the movie. But it looked
I haven't watched it in a long time.
Great movie.
I haven't seen 28 Days Later in forever, but I think a couple years ago, probably 2019, I saw 28 Weeks Later in a theater.
Really good.
Yeah. And that was a trip.
Scene? Oh, yeah. When he leaves his wife behind, the opening scene, remember that?
Oh, yeah. No, and it looked beautiful. I believe the context of that screening, it was a Terror Tuesday, and our programmer at the time, Mike Keegan, out here at the Alamo, was literally counter-programming it because in Austin they were showing 28 Days. And he's like, nah, Weeks is better. We're showing that.
It is better. Well, the chopper scene was like chopping off the
heads. Oh, dude. The chopper scene was literally the only thing I remembered.
Right?
Yeah, going into it, I'm like, dude, yeah, it rules.
Well, it's for counter-programming, he should have shown 8.5 weeks. Or 9.5 weeks. What is it? 9.5 weeks. Oh, thank you so much. Eight and a half.
Yeah, we need Fellini in there. Now, Gerald, you mentioned the helicopter scene. I can't help but think that was the inspiration for your drone kill in the first movie you made now.
Shit, you know what? Now you know. The word is out.
Dude, honestly.
Maybe it was. I mean, I don't know if I meant it to be, but yeah, probably.
Subconsciously, it's in there.
Subconsciously, yeah. Could have been.
Dude, I love that fucking drone kill. I think when we were making the catalog for that year, I believe I pulled a frame from that and used it in there. Right? Am I tripping? I know. I think I did.
You did. Yeah, I think it was in there. It was totally in there. It was in the what do you call it? The program?
Yeah. In our program booklet. So, yeah. Gerald, man, we're so excited to talk to you because I'm excited
to talk to you guys, man. You guys rule.
You know, you came back this year, and I don't think I can express properly how exciting it was to get another feature film from you when you submitted to UF5. And instantly our group chat blew up, and we're like, holy shit, Gerald's got another movie.
He's back, baby.
Yeah. And if I'm honest, I don't even think we needed to watch it, and we would have just been like, hey, if he's coming out, let's just show it so we can hang out with him.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was a double bonus when your movie just fucking it just rocks, dude. You did it.
I was really relieved at the screening how it went over because, you know, you just don't know. Right.
Yeah.
There's just no way of knowing. What are people going to think of it? You know, you watch it with your cast, you know, you show a couple friends, and of course your friends are going to say they like it, whether they, you know, like it or not.
Yeah.
So you just don't know. You just don't know. So I was just relieved that the jokes went over, really. That people, like, they were laughing, right? Because, I mean, that's essentially a comedy. So I was like, oh, good. They're laughing. That's all that matters to me, you know?
Gerald, dude, the improvement from your first film to this one, it's fucking incredible. And, you know, just for people listening who didn't make it out, you had maybe one of the roughest spots in the whole festival, which was Sunday night. And, you know, as programmers coming out of like fucking COVID, we were already like, everybody was like, who's going to turn up? And especially in the Bay Area, like people aren't jumping for joy really to even take off their masks out here yet.
Yeah.
So we're like, well, we hope we have a turnout. And we really wanted to close with you because the closing movie is always like impactful for us as programmers. And we closed with you last time when we had you, and it just felt right. Uh-huh. So I got dubbed a reverse bouncer this year for pressuring people to stay. And I remember I was pushing my hardest with yours. Although, actually, I think I was kind of shocked. Like, everybody was kind of hanging out. They're like, I want to watch Alien Report and My Inner Demon.
Sweet.
And I'm like, dude, fucking thank you. And I'll tell you, we've seen the audience scores. People liked it, man. Because they are not... amenity will make people very vile when they want to be. And right. There was none of that.
And also, okay. You know, 16 hours of movies will also make them very honest.
Yeah.
No kidding, right? Yeah, no kidding. That is a long time to be sitting there. If you stay for the whole day like that is, well, I didn't do that this time. I watched quite a few films, but yeah. So the first Unnamed Footage Festival, I think I watched almost all the movies.
Shit.
I might have like took a little break here and there to go and eat and might have missed a couple. But yeah, it's a long time to be sitting there.
Oh, yeah.
Highly entertaining movies. Really, really interesting movies, for sure.
Well, they're really demanding, too. Like, you know, with the Spielberg film, you get to kind of just, like, lay back and forget about life. But a lot of the found footage narratives, they really are confronting. Like, even in your new film, there's a lot of reality in it. So it's kind of like an anti-escape, when you want to think about it that way. Or, like, I don't know, you have to be an active participant with these films. And, dude, after 2 days of them, you start to burn out. And I think, you know, the fact that you had a lot of humor in your story really helped us as programmers, because it kind of, you got to inject these people with some life again.
Nice. Well, I'm glad you found it funny. I mean, the whole thing was pretty much improvised. I mean, we had like a story, but more or less it was just me goofing around in the woods and acting goofy for most of it. So,
well, okay. Go ahead, Mark.
Well, I was just going to say, and you know, you and Darren, man, have great chemistry together. Oh, and that's why, you know, when I was, when we did the Q&A at the festival, that's why I kind of asked him, like, how long have you guys known each other? And you were like, well, pretty much met him, you know, when we filmed the first movie. And that was just incredible to me that, you know, because you guys just have really good natural chemistry together, that it just seems like, you know, that was part of the faux documentary, part of like a real relationship dramatized. But, you know, man, it was just seamless.
He's a funny guy. Like, he is. He's naturally a funny dude, right? And he's a really good actor, as you could see in the movie, right? With the Shakespeare and just with everything he was doing. And he's a great improviser too, right? He just says yes to stuff and he'll just do it, right? Which just makes someone like that really easy to work with. So, yeah, he was on board for the whole thing, and yeah, he was super cool to work with. He had a lot of good ideas for the movie too. Like, you know, he kind of co-wrote it. He came up with a lot. Well, I guess he is one of the co-writers. He came up with a lot of ideas for the film.
Mm-hmm.
That whole section with the car, where he gives me the car.
Yeah.
Right. That whole section, that was all his, like, that was all his idea for that. And that worked out pretty good. I don't know. Like, that got some pretty good laughs. So yeah.
Yeah. That was a good part.
He was, he was great. I love that scene with him in the garage, when I find him in the garage.
Right? Oh yeah.
He's like, oh, hi, Jerry. It's just so funny. It's just so awkward and weird, right? Like,
man,
his character just comes off like so strange, you know, and it's just exactly what the movie needed. It's really, I guess it's a buddy movie, kind of, right? Kind of like just a...
Oh, totally.
100%.
Well, here's the thing. How much of that was like a character he was playing versus like him being him?
Well, he's not a strange guy. He's a very down-to-earth person. And of course, in the movie, he's pretty weird. But yeah, his like personality, like his, the way he talks and everything, and like, you know, his mannerisms and everything, I guess that's Darren. But yeah, he's not like a dysfunctional guy or anything. Like, he's not a drunk like in that movie.
No. I was asking because I think part of the reason why your movie worked so well is just it felt authentic. Like, a lot of it just felt like you on camera and him being him, and you kind of turning that into something that's just entertaining to watch. Like, it's, yeah, a thing, you know, I try to articulate, it's almost like American Movie. Have you seen that?
American Movie. I don't think I've seen it. I don't think I have.
It's the documentary about a couple of dudes trying to make a low budget horror film. And yeah, it's not like a groundbreaking subject matter. And it's not like, I don't know, it's nothing super highbrow, but these two dudes are just incredible to watch. They're just real people. It's unfiltered. And that's really a thing that I think a lot of found footage filmmakers struggle with tapping into.
Right.
And, you know, even comparing it to your first film, one of the things that I didn't like about that one was it felt like you were navigating how to get exposition into the film. Totally. And we had the wraparound with the like kind of cop procedural.
Uh-huh.
And in this one, you've taken a vlogger role. And, yeah, you know, Leslie Manning, she directed Ghost Watch. She talked about trying to figure out how to get your story out in a authentic way. And she's like, you know, the thing is, when you have journalists on location, they literally tell you what they're doing. Like, it's, yeah, not like you have to hide the exposition. They're in the camera, yeah, and they're just like, we're here doing this. And it felt like you had figured that out.
Well, I mean, I gotta be honest. I mean, I take a lot of inspiration from the movie Creep, right?
Oh, yeah.
And the thing about Creep, what I love about it more than all other found footage films is that it's so character focused.
Mm-hmm.
The movie's just focused basically for the most part on a singular character, more or less focused on the Mark Duplass character, right? I mean, there's chemistry between the two characters, but he's kind of the central focus. And it just makes it real simple, right? Just makes the movie really simple. We're just focusing on these characters, right? We're just telling the story through these characters. And I don't know, for found footage, that I think that really kind of speaks to me, right? Just making it as simple as possible, very streamlined. And in this movie, of course, it was kind of just more or less focused on two characters. And then, of course, we had some external characters too. We had like Jimmy, we had the witch, right? To help move the story along, which were really interesting characters as well. But I just like to keep it simple and edgy, make it kind of edgy. You know, Darren's character was kind of edgy, right? Kind of a edgy, sort of make you uncomfortable type of character, right?
For sure.
Possession into there. And yeah, excuse me. I just thought it was really well done. Like, in terms of like Creep was a really well done film, right? Creep 2 had a great dynamic to it. And obviously this is a lot different because you have sort of a possession aspect to it. But the other thing I thought when making this was Nigel's films. Nigel Bock.
Bad Ben.
His Bad Ben movies. I've only seen the first Bad Ben.
Okay.
I've only seen that one.
Yeah.
But you know what? I thought it was pretty cool. It was pretty simple. It was a pretty simple movie, right? Pretty straightforward. I think he shot it with his iPhone.
Yep.
And he added in that, you know, he had that paranormal element in there. And just from a marketing perspective, I kind of thought, that's kind of cool. You know, like, people in the found footage community seem to kind of more geared towards the paranormal side of things as opposed to the serial killer story. Seems like that to me, like looking at the forums, people are more into that. So I thought, well, you know, if we could kind of take the simplicity of Creep, kind of the simple way of storytelling, and then just kind of put kind of a paranormal angle into it. That was just sort of like the inspiration when I did this.
Well, there's something interesting there.
nothing like it, I guess.
So yeah. when we're talking paranormal versus serial killer, I've been reading a lot of literature on like people trying to like figure out what the different interaction with like found footage or in-world camera is.
Right.
And one of the things they talk about is giving your audience agency, which is something in other movies you don't really have. Like one of my favorite things about Creep 2.
Oh, great.
And I apologize. I say this all the time on the show is remember when he's standing up there like naked.
Yeah.
And he's it's a power play. And he's like, I'm up here naked and I'm not scared of the camera. Uh-huh. And he does it to her. And she's like, well, I can do that too. Now, the thing that you could only do in found footage is when she gets like topless, the camera moves away.
Yeah.
And it shows that like he actually is like lesser behind the camera. Like there's a thing being articulated only through film language.
Hmm.
And yeah, and it's interesting. And when we watch Creep, the audience, we become a voyeur. Like we're watching shit that we probably shouldn't be. But when we're watching paranormal shit, I feel like we're not a voyeur. We're like a PI.
Right.
So it's almost like we're kind of like a good guy in a way.
Right.
Like, hey,
right.
I'm here. I'm helping out. And I'm combing over your footage. I'm looking for the you know, the speck or like the dust particle flying in front of the lens. Dude, if you like Bad Ben, you got to watch our highbrow Bad Ben, the Blackwell ghost. Have you dug into that at all?
No.
Oh,
dude.
Gerald.
It's good. Is it well done? Really well done?
It's well, all right. yes. Short answer, yes. But it takes a different direction once we get to 3.
Okay.
And I think we hit a new level when we hit 3. 1 is my least favorite, but it's still very good. But it's a good introduction. All of these movies are, Russ, they're all about an hour.
Yeah, they're all like an hour long.
And there's 5 of them currently. You can knock them out in a day, and that's kind of how I did it. I just went on a little Blackwell Ghost marathon, and I love it.
Now, it is Bad Ben behind a paywall, which I think now that Bad Ben teamed up with Breaking Glass, he might be behind one too. Can when do you guys check and see if Blackwell Ghost is available on Amazon for like... Yeah. For free,
it's a you have to rent.
You have to rent them all.
I think the first one's for rent, and then you got to pay the rest.
So
they give you a little taste for free.
Yeah,
to try to hook you,
dude. The direction you went in My Inner Demon, I feel like you're in between the Bad Ben and the Blackwell Ghost, and nice. I mean that as far as like authenticity, like Blackwell Ghost. I'm not sure, but I don't think the director's done any interviews. Because he's kind of maintaining what a lot of YouTubers do, where if they have like a paranormal show and they're opening up like Divic boxes or like dark web boxes,
right.
They don't want to literally tell you it's fake.
Right.
He's committing to the bit.
Yeah. We're
committing to it. Okay.
We're like Nigel, you know, he's doing more of kind of a character thing and he's having a lot of fun. I mean, Nigel's got fucking 10 movies under his belt. He made a cartoon pilot on Amazon Prime.
He had a streaming service where he put UFC MMA fights on it.
Yeah.
I saw that. Wrestling matches and stuff.
Yeah. So I don't know. I think it's really interesting. You kind of you transform the audience in your new film. And you know, comparing it to Creep, the beautiful thing about Creep is it's kind of a magic trick. Like we've only got 2 characters in that movie and it's titled Creep.
So simple, right? So
yeah. Simple. And you're like, well, this guy's bad, right? And the whole movie is just this tug of war with the audience where it's like, maybe he's not bad.
Yeah.
Maybe it's the camera. Nope. And the whole time you're like, I'm pretty sure Mark Duplass is a maniac.
Yeah.
And it's a magic trick. By the end of it, hopefully you just didn't see where we were going. And you've kind of tapped into that too, because your stand-up character, that dude, you hooked us with that at, what was that, Up 3? When we had, it was 2. And I just remember being like, whoa, this Gerald dude's a character. Like we gotta like look into this. And Clark was like smitten with your movie. So it's like, all right, let's do it. And then when you came back this time, I don't know, man. I feel like your film's just like elevated beyond a character study. Like, there's a lot of you really in this movie.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's weird because I honestly, and even today, I haven't put a lot of thought into the movie. I mean,
damn it.
I was really focused on getting it done, right?
Yeah.
Just after Murderbox, it was Murderbox was just it was so hard to make. I spent so much time on it and editing it and trying to put it together. And then we had that kind of wraparound. We brought Darren into that.
Mm-hmm.
We had him like explaining it, right? Because it didn't really flow or make sense before. So we added that. We ended up adding a scene at the end that wasn't even in the festival. There's an end scene. I think there's a scene after the credits, an after credits scene. It was just so much work. And it just felt like such a heady experience. Like I was just me and Jimmy, the guy that I made it with Jimmy Gannon, we just spent so much time, you know, trying to piece this movie together and put so much thought into it. And so this time, yeah, honestly, I just wanted to have fun. I was like, let's just make a movie. Let's make it simple. Let's just tell a story. It doesn't have to be too complicated. Let's make it funny. And let's have it make sense, but let's not over-explain, you know? And by not over, and when I say not over explaining it, I mean not even really thinking too much about it. You don't really, in My Inner Demon, they don't really explain how Geraldson comes out of him, right? How my inner demon, my monster, my creation, you know, how it really happens. I mean, he plays with a Ouija board, and next thing you know, he's being hunted by his own inner demon, right? We don't do a lot of explaining, and it's kind of left unknown to the audience. And I think that's good. I think it kind of makes it a little scarier for the audience as well. One movie I really like is It Follows, I guess.
Sure.
Follows. They don't explain anything. Nothing's explained. It's all left to your imagination. It's just like, okay, this thing is following you, right? And we don't know what it is. We don't really understand it. We don't really know. And it just makes it so much more interesting. One thing that kind of bothers me in movies is when they when they overexplain this stuff. I take too much time, like you were saying earlier, Russell, with the exposition. Okay, yeah. Now we need to slow the movie down. We need to have a scene that fully explains what happened here. And there, sure, in My Inner Demon, there's some explanation, right? And there's a reason that it happens, but it's a little ambiguous, right? And I think that makes it a little more interesting, right? Gets the audience thinking. Yeah.
Yeah, when, you know, it's interesting because when we're watching a, I don't know if I want to call it a faux doc, but like kind of a vlogger right. Protagonist.
Yeah.
You can do interesting shit. Like there's so many elements of documentary in found footage. And one of them is like a privilege moment. And if a character has something that's going to transform them, play out on screen.
Oh.
And then, you know, you have the ability to turn to the camera and give exposition that's a lie. Like, say, like, you walk in on your girlfriend cheating, and then you close the door and you walk away and you ignore it. Like, you've just expressed something to your audience that they'll pick up. And it's like, now you're doing the complete opposite of exposition, or you're kind of leaning into it. So there's so many, like, hard to articulate things that can happen when you have like that vlogger style. Yeah. And go ahead.
Yeah, no, I agree. I completely agree. Yeah.
Man, it was so interesting. And where did you film that? Was that by your house?
The stuff in the woods and stuff.
Yeah.
It's outside of Vancouver. It's this place called Maple Ridge. And we shot a lot of it out in Maple Ridge, like where we saw that bear.
Mm-hmm.
That really happened. That was actually that thing was big, man.
It sounds terrifying.
You can't really see it on the camera, like how big it is, but it was big, man. When that thing started running through the woods, when it left the river,
yeah,
you just hear the footsteps, man. Just, like, holy shit, right? We did not stick around for long after.
Good call.
Was that your first time seeing a bear in the wild?
Yeah. Like, no, well, no, actually, I had another experience with a bear. Where it was like when I was working in film on a set where I ran into a bear, not on a set, but like in the, I guess in the parking lot area ran into a bear. That was
The Revenant.
Pretty much. It was not that sad. But it was pretty freaky, man. It wasn't a CGI bear. It was a real bear. But this one in the woods was a lot scarier. And I believe that was the second time we shot in that wood, in the woods. The first time was at night, where we did the scene with the axe, where Darren starts scaring me with the axe. That was like the first scene we shot. We ended up reshooting that. So there was three times we were in the woods there in Maple Ridge. And then after seeing the bear, I didn't film in that wood, in those woods again. We went and filmed in a park, this place called Green Timbers Park in Surrey. You don't have to worry about bears. And it's the same place where we shot a lot of Murderbox, the clown scene and stuff. We did it in there. So that was pretty good. And I like filming in the woods. It's fun, you know?
Well, look at that. Look at that privilege moment. You caught your first bear encounter on camera.
Yeah. I mean, we got it on camera. That was cool.
It's funny because, you know, we're kind of talking about like found footage horror franchises with Bad Ban and Blackwell Ghost. But hearing, like, kind of thinking about Murderbox and My Inner Demon, I feel like you're on a reverse trajectory of Stephen Cognetti, who did Hell House. And I don't know if you remember, Clark, we talked to him, God, years ago.
Oh, he's awesome.
Dude, and Hell House LLC is incredible, right?
Oh, I love that movie.
And then he made part two.
And it's not incredible, apparently.
No. And I think, you know, what you did with Murderbox was you kind of, you came to it, and you're like, I'm going to make a movie, and you have locations, and you got actors, yeah. And it's all this craft. And then, you know, you came with My Inner Demon and you're like, well, I didn't really think about it. We just made it.
Yep.
And all that's all like, it's you. It's authentic.
It cost a quarter of the budget.
Really? So what did you spend that all on? Your head?
The head was already made. I had that from before.
Oh, yeah.
That didn't really cost anything. It was all just basically, I guess, just the equipment I bought, the camera, some of the lights, and just like sound gadgets and gas and food, like feeding people and stuff. And it was super shoestring budget. And then, like, I guess I had to pay for some sound effects that are added in there, like Soundstripe. And yeah, it was low budget. I don't know how much it cost. I didn't really not much.
See,
it was thousands of dollars. I mean, yeah. It's not cheap to make any movie. You're going to be spending money. We needed, like, you know, more hard drive space. Had to buy like a new hard drive for my computer, things like that. There were definitely expenses. I mean, it was definitely more than $5,000. I guess I don't know. Didn't really keep track of it, but I know that with Murderbox, it cost a fortune to make. It cost so much money. And I'll never make that back.
So. Well, you know, I don't mean to laugh because that is kind of a bummer. So, one of the critiques I got from a couple of people from My Inner Demon was that it's kind of built upon Murderbox in a way where that might hope the audience knows what Murderbox is. Now, right. One of the people who told me that was Ilan Sheedy. He's the dude that did all the art for our fest. Oh, and he's one of the most thoughtful, kind of like, he really immerses himself in the movies. Like, if you ever look at the art that he does for Blu-ray covers, he always talks about, like, he has to watch a movie a few times and kind of really wants to, like, portray the vibe of the film.
Right.
And a lot of the time he'll push back on the people who are hiring him and be like, I think you're misbranding it. But he came to me and he was like, you know, I didn't even know Murderbox was a movie. And then he told me how he went back and found it and watched it. Mm. And I'm like, you know, he was kind of articulating this as a bad thing. But right. I'm like, dude, you've literally done what all found footage movies want. It's like, now there's almost like an ARG element. And there's like, wait, there's more of this? And he went back and watched it and engaged with it. So
that's good, right?
Yeah. No, I'm like, that nails it.
And that's how you'll make your money back, Gerald.
Honestly, I'm not going to lie. That was kind of the thought. It's, you know, I would like people to go back and watch the other film. That would be great. It's not really about making money, but it would be great if more people watched it, right? I mean, we did spend a lot of time working on it, and some people really liked it. And I think, you know, even though it's not a perfect movie, there's stuff to appreciate there. And I'm hoping people will go back and check it out. If you like Geraldson, you'll probably dig Murderbox. You get to see a lot of them, right?
So he,
how can you not love Triple G?
Right.
Now, it's great, funny because you said you only watched the first Bad Band.
And yeah, well, the first one.
Now, the thing about that movie is, again, I know people have heard this a bunch, but he lost all of his cast and it was like, fuck it, I'm making the movie anyway. And it's only him. And we talked to Nigel, I think, when he only had one movie out. Part two was a script. I think he was going to make some like military movie.
Oh, look, to be clear, we were outside of Nigel Bach. Everyone in this room outside of Randy, because he didn't like to participate in cool things. We were the first people on the planet to view Stillmanville Road. He sent it to us first.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. And it was terrible. Yeah. Here's the thing.
I heard the second one. It's the second one you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and people didn't like it. And he wasn't really in it, right? It was other people in it.
That was the problem.
Exactly.
That's the problem. Yeah.
That's why I think it's incredible that you figured it out. And what we liked about Murderbox was you. And what we liked about Bad Ben was Nigel Bach. And in part two, he's like, well, I died, so I'm going to hire some people and we're gonna make a real movie. Now I know what I'm doing. And I'm like, Nigel, you didn't listen to anything I told you. Because in that first podcast, I'm like, dude, we like you. You're a character, dude, and we want to watch you. So
yeah. People love watching this guy. He's like a middle-aged guy, you know, walking around, basically vlogging, I guess. Like,
swearing at ghosts. Yeah, dude, it's incredible.
He's hilarious. He's super entertaining. He's so charismatic.
And you know, now he's made Bad Ben Benign. Nine is the last film he's made. He's already working on another.
How is it? How are those? I haven't seen them. I kind of want to see some of them.
Go ahead.
Seven. Seven is the best of the franchise, and then I think Nine is right there. Benign is great. Pandemic is mostly fan service.
Yeah.
And not that interesting.
Mandela
is also very good. Batter nice. Ben is also very good. That's Bad Ben 4?
Batter Ben?
No, Batter Ben is 3.
Batter Ben is 3,
and then we've got...
The Texas Chainsaw franchise was hard to follow.
No, here's my favorite. Bad Ben 4 is the final chapter. It's not.
And then there's a Crescent Moon Clown.
Crescent Moon Clown, I think, is 5.
I'm intrigued by that one. That just sounds weird.
I believe it's him and his roommate deal with the clown.
Seven really? Is great. Seven, he's playing a rideshare driver, driving around a bunch of Draculas and...
Yeah, so check this out. All the movies take place in his real home, except for Seven, where he, for some reason, he's lost his home. And now he's trying...
in a tent.
He lives in a tent, which is a light spoiler, but he drives around on a rideshare, and so it's Halloween night. And everybody he picks up is getting a ride to his old house. I'm like, hell of a premise right there.
It's not a spoiler. I just ruined a joke. That's all.
I mean, you can't really spoil that film. It's really about just watching it.
Go ahead.
No. I feel like earlier you talked about how you were kind of trolling the Texas Chainsaw, like Facebook fans, right? I feel like if you threw on the makeup and just started TikToking like that, and you were just some weirdo, like commentating on horror films, that would go over great. It's so like, I would please don't do TikTok. I don't want to download the app, but if you were doing it on Instagram or something, YouTube, I would totally tune in.
My buddy who's, he does like Evil Dead, the musical and stuff. He like produces one of those shows. And I used to tour with him and he's a real huge horror fan and we're really good friends. He lives in Bellingham. He's always been telling me, like, you know, and he really got me onto like Joe Bob Briggs,
yeah, sure,
and his stuff. But he really tells me, he's been telling me for a long time, he's like, you should do a show. And I'm thinking about it. I don't know if I'll do it or not, but a show where you show like old horror movies like on YouTube and you host it, kind of like Elvira.
Yeah. Oh, dude.
Horror host.
Yeah. Like that kind of stuff.
Gerald would be the best horror host.
Dude, that'd be incredible.
That's a perfect medium for that character.
It would be, you know?
Perfect.
And it'd be a fun little pastime thing to do on the side, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know who would be a huge fan of that is our former third chair, Justin Coote,
who
he loves like horror hosts, and we actually have a community out here in the Bay Area who kind of they're like the old guys who are really into Godzilla movies and they just fucking, they're like historians when it comes to like regional horror hosts. And it's, yeah. I don't know. I feel like I've been waiting for somebody to kind of tap into that. Joe Bob, like the problem is Joe Bob's a real dude and he's got a cowboy hat on. So instantly there's an audience that's like, oh fuck that guy. Like he's in Texas, like fuck him. Like everything's too political now. But if you're
this guy's a Republican, that kind of
thing. And it's like, dude, what the fuck? So like, I don't know. If we had a character, I would totally, I think it would go over great. And you're Canadian, so everybody loves them. Well, I mean, Trudeau's kind of put a little
not truckers.
Lately they're not big fans of Trudeau.
Yeah.
Lately. But I don't know. It would be, I think it might be good. I don't know. I mean, it might be worth trying. And I guess there's these old movies you can get that are just a public domain, right?
Yep.
What he was saying is you use these public domain films, and that way you have the right to show them.
Night of the Living Dead's public domain.
It is. And you can actually make money off this stuff by doing it too. And it could be entertaining, but I don't know. What about getting subscribers? Like YouTube, it's tough to get subscribers. How do you?
Gerald, that's next week's episode. I know.
Actually, Oksana, if you want to jump in here, she's been listening to podcasts about trying to figure out algorithms for different social media platforms. It sounds like she's been hired for another job.
Yeah, she does not touch on YouTube at all, though.
Oh, the girl that you've been...
They're big proponents of LinkedIn on that podcast, which I refuse to like get involved in.
That's what we do. We get Geraldson to do a horror show on LinkedIn exclusively. At the end of every episode, you could update your resume.
That might work, you know? That's a niche. It's a real niche audience there.
God. Well, fuck, Gerald. I just want to see you do more. And, you know, when we were across the street at Hockey Haven on Sunday night, I was kind of shocked at how many people came up and they're like, hey, man, I got Gerald's contact. I got a script idea for him. How many people were bugging you about that?
Well, there's one director in particular has been talking to me about that. So,
okay, good. Don't ruin nothing. I loved it. They're like, man, I got an idea for him. And I believe I know who you're talking about. And he told me about this thing for like 15 to 20 minutes. And I honestly, I was loving it.
So we'll see. We might be able to do that. I mean, the guy you're talking about, he's really interested, I guess, in me acting in this project, like a future film. So
where are you at?
Where am I at with that?
Yeah. Like, do you want to keep doing stuff? Or I almost get the vibe that you're kind of like over film now.
No, not a chance. Okay. One sec here. I think I'm just getting I'm getting a bit of a cold or something here.
That's how it starts.
Yeah, exactly. It's concerning. No, absolutely not. I want to go full force with film. Absolutely. I have no intentions of slowing down. I've invested quite heavily in gear recently, in much better gear than I used for my last couple films. And I'd like to keep rolling with it. I'm just kind of like, I'm looking at a project right now that I want to do. And it's something that I think I'd want to maybe kickstart, because it's going to be a little bit higher end, I guess. It's kind of a bigger project.
Ooh.
Probably on the scope of something like Terrifier, like that sort of budget and that type of violence, you know, that sort of camp.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm looking at, I'll just tell you, you know what? It's the idea is sort of like a ninja warrior, serial killer. Have you ever seen Ninja 3, The Domination?
Yeah.
Yeah. So sort of that kind of thing, sort of like a paranormal ninja psycho killer movie. And all the weapons are sort of like oversized, like, and the ninja dude is like really big, so kind of the opposite of what you expect, like the, you know, the small slender agile guys, kind of like a bigger bulkier version.
Love
of
it.
Gerald, are you playing the ninja?
I don't know. I do take martial arts, but I don't know if I'll be at that.
Whoa, hold on, what kind of martial art are you training?
MMA a little bit. Yeah.
Are you doing mixed? Are you doing like BJJ or?
It's mixed martial arts. It's mostly at this point, it's mostly like kickboxing.
Wait, cool. BJJ, Russell, that's one too many J's. Thank you so much.
Okay.
I haven't gotten into any grappling yet. I don't know if I would play it or not. I would definitely act in it. I definitely would be in the movie for sure. Maybe I could be like a detective.
Well, Gerald, take it easy with that because you have beautiful ears, all right? And there's no room for cauliflower on your produce aisle, okay?
Oh, that's a great idea. Cauliflower ears would be really great if the ninja had like huge cauliflower ears and maybe like his ears.
You're welcome.
But the idea is like really oversized. Just picture like really oversized weapons. So like his sword is like really oversized. It's like the size of like a machete, or maybe he uses a machete instead of a ninja sword, or his like throwing stars are like the size of hubcaps. Like they're just
love it.
That's the idea, right? Yeah. And maybe he's all burnt. I was thinking maybe like, you know, half the mask is like burnt off and his face is all burnt like Freddy Krueger on the one side and his ninja mask is like burnt off and that sort of thing. And just kind of like really fun, like super gory, really fun movie. We can have some elements in there of found footage, I think would be cool. Cause I obviously love found footage. So it'd be awesome to have some of those elements in there, but more of a traditional kind of movie that's been spinning around in my head for a while. And I'm working on that right now. So I want to do that. I want to do something big, something a little bigger.
I think like
keep doing found footage too, but just that's kind of my next thing.
Hey, I mean, you can stay alive in our genre with shorts if you need to. We sure. definitely need more from you, but if
we'll
you,
give you, I'll give you more.
If you're feeling a roided out ninja who brutally massacres people and is juxtaposed against like Triple G comedy. Hey, I would hate to discourage that. So yeah. I'm in.
You guys will be on board. It'll be good.
Well, also, if you do a damn Kickstarter, you got to let us know.
I will. Oh, yeah. You guys can help with that, I guess.
I got housekeeping.
What? Leave your camera on. You help. God damn it.
You guys helped with the Kickstarter recently for somebody.
Yeah, we do. Well, we try to all the time. And mostly, it's a weird position to be in because we're kind of like panhandling to our audience. So mostly we kind of lightly push and then we all just donate. Like I think the last one for Chicken Surprise, we all bought like the $70 pack or whatever.
Oh, that's awesome. That's really cool. Yeah. But yeah, I want to do, I'll probably end up doing another one of these movies too. One of these found footage films. I could see it happening again. You know, and the thing is, if it takes too long to make this ninja movie, if it's like, you know, because it's gonna take a while to raise the money and to develop it, do the artwork, you know, and fully develop that movie.
Yeah,
it'll take a while. I mean, who knows? In between, we might have another My Inner Demon movie. That could happen too. It's not; they're not that hard to make. They're not that
my
hard
outer demon.
My outer demon. That's hilarious. Dude, that's actually really funny. My outer demon.
Gerald, we should be co-writers. That's all I'm saying. Well, I like that's it. All I'm saying.
I probably would call it that, to be honest. I don't even know if thought I put into this. I'm like, yeah.
Now, I don't want to discourage the ninja movie, but Clark is impossible to work with. Get off this road. Swerve the car.
Oh, yeah. Here's the title for the ninja movie. I'm really not wrong. Real long and hard on this. Maniac Ninja.
Love it.
That's it. Now, Maniac Ninja.
That movie is okay. That title is so straightforward and seems to work. I'm gonna Google it for you.
It might exist already.
I'm like, that has to be.
Is it a thing?
There's something on YouTube, but let me see. According to Randy, that's not real film.
This is true.
YouTube movies? Yeah.
I don't see a Maniac Ninja movie. Good. I see Ninja Mania from 1987. Ninja Mania.
What about
Enter the Ninja last night? We watched that last night.
Oh, hell yeah.
On a tear. That was pretty funny.
Well, I tell you what, I've got nothing to do here in Phoenix. I may just rewatch all the Texas Chainsaws today. Let's talk about good, it. Man. I got to watch 3D, see how bad it is.
Oh, you know, that movie, at the time I was dating this girl and I was talking to her about that movie for like weeks. I was like, it's coming out. I'm so excited. Like, I'm like,
that's
like Star Wars for me. You're gonna love that shit. I get so excited when there's a Texas Chainsaw Massacre coming out, and she didn't understand. It's like, this guy's weird. But then I took her to it. I'm like, let's go. It's gonna be great. It's gonna be so much fun. And then we go and watch it. It was so boring, Clark. I'm so bored, man. It is so lame. It's like 65-year-old Leatherface. I guess the same with this latest one. He's supposed to be old too.
But he's awesome.
In this one.
Yeah, the new one.
He's awesome.
Yeah.
But in this one, it's just, it's such a dumb movie. It's like the opening scene is kind of cool. They've got, is it that one? There's so many of them. Is that the one? Chainsaw 3D, where they open, they go back in time where they kill the Sawyers. It starts with them killing the Sawyer family. Is that it? Or is that Leatherface? I forget.
I mean, me and Clark talked past each other about him. One of these movies.
We have to go to our in-house Texas Chainsaw Massacre expert, Randy Statt. Randy.
I'm trying to look it up right now. I've only seen one, two, and the newest one.
This would be Texas Chainsaw 3D. I forget how it opens. I thought it was the one where they kill the Sawyers, but it might not be. There's either that movie or Leatherface, whichever. No, I think it was that one. I think it was 3D where they do that. That was kind of a cool opening, if that is, in fact, the correct movie. But after that, it's supposed to be 40 years later, and they take this niece. There's this niece who picks up 40 years later, and she's like 20 years old. She should be like 40 years old. She should be in her 40s. It makes no sense. It's just a glaring error in, like, you know, in logic. It's such a stupid film. So
boring. All right. Now yeah. After combing fucking IMDb, this is the one where they kill him. This is the one where Gunnar was in the beginning. And I think Bill Moseley's in it too. And
that's the one.
Yep. And this is actually the one that I liked because it kind of fell into that 80s, like, this movie doesn't really work, but they have Leatherface killing a bunch of people at a carnival at the end. Also, yeah. This movie didn't read like Texas to me. I kept imagining they were in like New Orleans. Like, it's right. Very, it's sweaty, and like they're kind of like in a swampy looking mansion.
Yep.
Yeah.
So did Joel Schumacher direct it?
Well, this one, God. It has a terrible line. So there's a connection. I don't know. God, I'm so paranoid about spoiling shit now because we get so much flack for it all the time. But in this one, it turns out somebody's related to Leatherface, and she yells out, "Get him, cuz."
Oh, yeah. Do you think, cuz, or whatever?
Man, and I just remember the blade of cringe thrusted deep into my heart and turned. I was writhing in my seat.
But that's how we should intro this show.
Get
the blade of cringe thrusted so far. Welcome to the Overlook Hour.
Maybe the maniac ninja could wield that blade.
Oh,
possibly.
No, I don't know. Gerald, if you are in a Foot Clan outfit and the mask comes off and it's not Geraldson, I think you're going to run into a bad Ben problem. People are going to be like, what the fuck, dude?
Wait. Have GGG be the head of the Yakuza.
Oh, that'd be all right.
That's the move.
Or what if GGG's the outer demon to the maniac ninja? And you kind of do one of those like American Werewolf in London where you're like a ghostly figure giving terrible advice.
Oh, that's very good.
Just keeps appearing.
That's very good.
I've had this idea where there's like this ripped guy in a gym. And he tries a new drug, like somebody in the locker room's like, hey, dude, we got something new. And I remember, fentanyl? Fentanyl. ODs, end of movie. No, when Barry Bonds was out here, there was the thing they were calling clear, which was he was injecting in his butt. And I always thought about, like, what if there's a guy who's kind of ripped, like, but he wasn't like superhuman looking like he wanted. And a dude sold him on something, but it like broke him. Kind of like the stuff or like street trash, like it's you've abused this thing and now you're turning into a monster. Dude, it'd be perfect if it like worked really well, but it's just now you're schizophrenic and your voice is Geraldson.
Whoa.
Yeah, we're gonna have to cut all this because it's gonna be gold.
That's right. No, this is our Kevin Smith Tusk moment.
Oh God.
Oh man.
I talk about a movie I love and hate.
Love that movie.
Yeah, I just God.
I love. He nails the horror. The comedy suffers for me on that end.
Dude.
Yeah, it's not like a funny, it's a bummer kind of a.
Oh yeah.
Well, Johnny Depp, he should have like pulled on that leash a little bit because he gets too fucking cute later on in that movie. And all the like real traumatic work they were doing in the beginning just kind of like flutters away.
Yeah, his character in that, I don't know about that. He was like a French Canadian guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't really know if his character was really necessary.
Well, yeah, he was like Jacques Tati if he was missing a chromosome.
Yeah, and I can't think, anytime anybody mentions a brown recluse, I think of that fucking movie now. Nobody brown. Else? Okay, I guess I'm the only one that walked away with that.
Oh, it's the Betsy Spile.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much.
Good job.
Such a bummer of a film, man.
Oh, I'm going to watch that today, too. I got a busy day today.
It was entertaining, though. It was definitely entertaining. It was scary. Like that. Whoever the lead actor is, the bad guy.
Justin Long.
Well, he's
Michael
the good
Parks.
Guy.
Michael Parks.
That guy, man, he was great in that.
R.I.P.
He was good. And what was the cult movie that?
Oh, Red State.
I thought that was pretty terrifying as well.
I've never watched it.
It's
that was all right.
It's half and half for me. Again, kind of like Tusk, but I don't know. I love the ending of Tusk, but
yeah. All right. Now, before we let you go, I have to bring up
anything's better than yoga hosers. All right, continue.
I totally agree. And yeah, I mean another one. The daughters there, they just got to do whatever they wanted, and I remember Madeline, RIP, one of the programmers for Unnamed Footage Festival, she loved the film. And I was like, how did you love this movie? And she's like, well, I have daddy issues. And that movie's all about a director just letting her daughter do whatever she wanted. And I'm like, okay, that's a good argument. Clark hated it because of terrible impersonations, if I remember correctly.
No, I got no beef with Ralph Garman.
Okay, I thought
it's
you were
just,
like...
No, it's not the impersonations. It's just the presentation
yeah.
of how that was done. It was like the platform. I was like, God, this is lazy and tired.
What was the movie called again?
Yoga Hosers.
Yoga Hosers.
Come on. You're a Canadian horror guy. He was going to do the Canadian trilogy. The new one was supposed to be Moose
Jaws.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That kind of sounded cool. I kind of
I think that's why he didn't make it.
No, and you know, I
all uncool movies.
Okay, Gerald, I know we're eating up your day here, but before you go, I have to. Did you watch X?
Yep, I did.
Now, as a Texas Chainsaw fan, how do you feel about it?
Yeah, it definitely had that vibe to it for sure. I forget what's the filmmaker's name? Ty West.
Yeah.
He did a great job. I have not seen House of the Devil. I want to see that next. So I really liked it. I thought it was really good. Really well acted, really well shot. Story was really cool, but I'm not a huge fan of watching old people fucking. Neither was my girlfriend.
Oh, was she that's mad? She please tell me she was
literally was like that. She's like, old people just shouldn't fuck on camera. That's all I got to say about that.
Oh man, damn it! I thought she was going to be more mad. Again, my favorite
the porn stuff. No, neither did I. I mean, whatever. That's fine.
Yeah.
But just the like, I guess you know, it was just weird. It's really weird. I mean, I liked it. It was a good movie. Did you guys like it?
Yeah, I did. Clark did not.
Who didn't like it?
I didn't like it.
You didn't like it. Okay. Well, I liked it, but I didn't love it because, I don't know, like the old villains, I don't know. They're just, you know, they're just not, they're not the most formidable opponents. I mean, well, I kind of looked at it like, you know what? I could just kick their ass if they came after me.
Well, I just, I did like that little bit of a the old man did turn out to be a Marine who had the ability to act like a slasher and move completely silently through the woods.
That's but true.
I think the hurdle that I think both me and Clark got hung up on was how monster-fied they tried to make the old people. Because clearly we got a theme here of like youth and vitality and like kind of just being dumb. And yeah, then like wisdom, but like also like just having all the trauma of life catch up with you while your body's breaking down.
Right.
And they, instead of actually having like old people, they just, you know, dolled them up and made them kind of like, they were kind of like creature feature monsters almost.
And yeah, they were weird looking.
Yeah. I don't know.
The makeup was good, but it was also like, yeah, it's makeup. I'm like, these look like young people wearing makeup. What do you think? No? Was it?
Well,
was
it, it is, I think, yeah. Actors?
Well, certainly one. And then I, the gentleman actor is far less younger than his portrayed character.
He is younger. Yeah, way younger, right?
I think he's probably 50, 60s.
Right, probably.
And yeah, and his face doesn't look like a like he's aged like a bag of milk.
Well, here's the thing. I felt like you did, Gerald, and I was like, oh, interesting. Why did they do that? And then I learned that there was a post-credits scene, which was a trailer for the prequel film. And right, I'm like, oh, that's cool. That's interesting. And they're like, it's already shot. I'm like, wait, it's real?
Yeah, I'm going to go see it. Yeah.
So there's a trilogy there.
That's cool. I mean, I think, honestly, the prequel will probably be better.
Yeah, might be better. I'm worried. I'm worried it's going to be too much.
It could be. I mean, it was a hell of a good film, right? It was really, it was well written, well shot. I mean, the whole thing was, it was unique, very original.
Well, it's also got a pretty funny premise surrounded by like kind of grotesque gore.
Yeah.
So I feel like it's a pretty good, I don't know, footnote for My Outer Demon.
My Outer Demon.
That's it.
I love it. I'm just, I'm getting, I think I'm going to roll with that. If we do a sequel, it's going to be called My Outer Demon.
There we go.
That's just,
I love it.
The one thing is, though, with this Inner Demon movie is I don't want to, I don't really want to market it as a Murderbox sequel.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think about how to, because, you know, Murderbox and all, I like it and all, but not many people know about it. So it's like, I kind of just want this to go to be on its own and then have people go and look for Murderbox later. But yeah, I'm just trying to figure out the marketing. So I want to release it fairly soon. It's just, you know, present it as a standalone movie. And then people are like, oh, wait, there's actually a Murderbox movie too? Oh, cool. Let's go watch that.
You know? Exactly. Yeah. I mean, it's already worked. I'm so.
Right?
Yeah.
It did work, yeah. I noticed that my Murderbox reviews went way up. Like, so way more people have watched Murderbox since this festival. And people are, have commented and stuff. I went and watched this. And I'm like, oh, that's cool.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Gerald, I don't know if you could tell, but we clearly just wanted to hang out with you today. And nice. And tell you, like, My Inner Demon was great, and we loved it.
Thanks,
and we really appreciated you coming out. And bringing a lady with you. You know, when you brought a lady friend, I was like, fuck, we lost Gerald. He's just going to be happy now and not need to make movies.
We're going to keep making movies for sure. She's a graphic designer, too, so she can help me.
Oh, perfect.
She's an awesome graphic designer. Leanne. Yeah, she's an amazing graphic designer. So that comes in handy when you're a filmmaker.
See, definitely. Russ, he just doubled down, baby. That's all he did.
It warms my heart.
Because I'm going to make more films, so.
All right, because Gerald, we're not done with you yet.
Good. I'll come back. Every time I'm in that festival, I'll show up. Even if it's just for a short film, I'll show up no matter what. I love coming out there. It's so expensive, though.
It is.
Why is it so expensive in San Francisco?
And we live here. Oh, my God.
You live in San Fran, right?
Yeah. Well, we live south of the city.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
We must have good jobs because it is. You must be well employed well because holy shit. Do you guys work in the tech industry or something? I'm not going
to. Fuck no.
I do.
Yeah.
You do? Okay.
Tech adjacent.
Okay.
Yeah, see, I'm the happy one. That's why I have like a job where I just pack boxes all day and listen to podcasts, and and I come home and I feel pretty good. Everybody else who's actually making money, they got some mental hurdles.
I bet they do.
Here, Oksana, this is your favorite segment in the show where we complain about how much our rent is. Do you want to go ahead and get on mic and and mention how much a month? I mean, because Clark does live here with me and Oksana.
Oh, cool.
Go ahead. You want to?
I mean, it takes three incomes. Let's just leave it at that.
You don't want to shock. You don't want to shock Gerald with the number.
I'll do it.
Go for it.
3,800.
3,800. Yeah.
For three bedrooms, 1,500 square foot condo.
Oh, it's three bedrooms though.
Three bedrooms, 1,500 square foot.
Well, that's not bad. I mean, I heard that like a one bedroom in San Fran was like 3,300 or something.
Oh yeah.
You could get a studio apartment in San Francisco for probably more than we're paying for here.
5,500 if you're on like a good street, and by good I mean like near Mission, 5,500 a month. It's like, what the fuck? Yeah, but again, Gerald, you know, we're in a new condo. They actually bulldozed a well that harbored many bodies of children who had met an untimely demise. We've been feeling the wrath of the ghost recently. They like to appear in an army of spiders. We call it Spider House often. Whoa. And also our concrete in front of our door was bubbling up once as gas was trying to explode from an old pipe. So, you know, it's a little affordable when you take into account all of the curses we deal with.
Was there literally a bunch of children that died? Was that I lied?
No.
Okay.
Unfortunately, that was the only lie there. We are constantly covered with spiders, and the concrete did bubble up inside of our in front of our house, and the whole street was evacuated.
Damn, man.
Honestly, the well seems easier to deal with.
I love the city, though. I do. Like, it is a cool ass city. Like, I don't care what anyone says. San Fran is super cool. Pretty wicked. Pretty rad.
Well, anything you want to bug Gerald about, Clark? I feel like we've milked all this time from him.
No, man, we love you. And keep doing what you're doing, man. And you always got a home here, baby.
Right on. I love you guys. I seriously do. I love coming out, and you guys are my friends. If I lived there, I feel like we'd hang out all the time. We'd watch movies, go to movies.
Oh, yeah.
I'd be one of the guys if I lived there.
We needed you in our screening of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You would have fit right in.
Yeah, I'm glad you guys like it, too. It just shows you're my kind of guys, you know? You like Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You like that movie.
Well, the fact that my favorite thing you said today is that the Texas Chainsaw Massacre franchise is your Star Wars. and that's why we're family here, Gerald.
I mean, maybe Evil Dead is, but that is too.
But yeah. There's only like four of those.
I know. That's a problem.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
Gerald, we love you, man.
Awesome talking to you guys.
Thanks, man. Yep.
Thank you for listening to this episode of The Overlook Hour. And if you would like to hear more, please subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or whatever your podcatcher of choice is. And while you're there, go ahead and give us a rating and or a review, which is a very easy way for you to support this show that we bring to you every week for years now, free of charge. And as always, you can find us on YouTube at The Overlook Theater, Instagram at The Overlook Theater, Facebook at The Overlook Hour, and Twitter at The Overlook Hour. Last but not least, you can send us your emails and tell us how much you like or dislike the show at overlookhour@gmail.com. And if you're nice, maybe we'll read them on the show. I've been your engineer, Randy Statt. Please join me along with Clark, Russell, and Oksana again next time. Bye.